Have you ever wondered how memories are stored in your brain or how you access them and what's going on inside your head when you're memorizing something? Well, this video is for you. We're gonna learn more about how the brain processes memories after the bump. Hey friends, how you doing? That's a really good color on you. I like that. Hey, I'm Doug Fall, your augmented actor, helping you augment your acting career with tips, tactics, and tech. Remember to subscribe. Today we're going to be talking about memory and the brain, your brain craw, and how it processes memories. The brain has three different main types of memory. There is sensory memory, there's short-term memory, and there's long-term memory. Sensory memory is the shortest. It's just a few milliseconds or seconds of sensory memory. So for instance, if you touch something that's hot, you will remember that sensation for just a few seconds. If you smell something and then that smell is removed, you will have a vivid sense of that smell for just a few seconds. Short-term memory is like the brain's scratch pad or post-it note. It holds about 5 to 9 bits of information at a time, and anything more than that, you gotta kind of drill it into your long-term memory. The function of short-term memory is to not completely forget something in the middle of a process. For instance, if you're reading a sentence, you need to remember what the first part of that sentence said until you get to the end of the sentence. So it's retaining little bits of information until you get to the end of a sentence. It's also helpful if you're translating into another language because you can hold on to the original phrase while you're translating it. And you can also complete tasks because you remember what you're doing while you're completing the task. Short-term memory lasts between a few seconds and a minute. That's about how long we can retain this information without drilling it further. And short-term memory is encoded mostly with audio cues and not so much with visual cues. The more similar the little bits of information are that you're trying to hold, the longer you'll be able to retain that information. For instance, if you're trying to remember a sequence of colors, red, yellow, green, blue, you might retain that information a little longer than if you were trying to learn red, rock, bird, number one, and Peter. Now you can retain more than 9 bits of information if you do what's called chunking. And chunking is grouping bits of information together into little chunks. Telephone numbers work this way. So you remember the area code and then the first 3 digits and then the last 4 digits. And therefore it's just 3 bits of information rather than 10. Bits of information. Now, if you want to retain information from your short-term memory and transfer it to your long-term memory, there are 3 general ways to do that. So number one is repetition, drilling it, going over and over and over again, repeating it, repeating it, repeating it. That's one way of getting it into your long-term memory. The second way is by giving it meaning or associating it with information that's already stored in your long-term memory, giving it a link to something that's already in your memory. And this is a much more effective way of getting short-term memories into long-term memory. And then the final way is by motivation, giving interest to the subject at hand. The more you're interested in it, the more it's going to sink into your long-term memory. Now, long-term memory stores information in your brain virtually forever. Most scientists believe that that information is stored in your brain permanently. Think of your brain like a library, and each bit of information is like a book that's on the shelf. And you have a system of neural pathways that are forged in your brain that tell you where a particular book is located in the library. It's like the Dewey Decimal System. Now, when we forget something, we're really just forgetting how to access that neural pathway, how to find that bit of information in the library. And so the more we review something that we have learned in the past, the more that pathway will be forged, the more we'll know directly where to go to find that particular bit of information. Now, long-term memory encodes semantically by meaning, by association, by word, and a little bit by audio. So it's kind of the opposite of short-term memory. So you're trying to remember a word or something and you use the phrase, that's on the tip of my tongue. That's when you're trying to recall something in long-term memory based on how it sounds rather than on meaning or association. And therefore, it doesn't always pop into your head because you're trying to recall it by the sound of it. And then later on, when you associate it with something else, it pops into your brain. There's a little part of the brain right in the middle called the hippocampus. And it acts as a transit center for information going from short-term memory to long-term memory. It's also a place where hippopotamuses go to school. So the hippocampus doesn't create memories. It's just sort of like your brain's CPU. It takes information from the short-term memory, consolidates it, associates it, and decides where to store it in the brain, depending on what kind of memory it is. The hippocampus also aids in forming those neural pathways. Now, when you forget something that's stored in your long-term memory, you're really kind of just overriding those neural pathways with new neural pathways that take you into a different direction. And so that information gets bypassed and forgotten. This process usually takes about 3 months for your brain to start to overwrite, unless you continue to revisit that memory or information. Another interesting fact about long-term memory is how language is processed. People who learn a new language are going to remember their early memories in their original language and their later memories in their new language. So this might be why when we're learning a piece of script with a dialect, for instance, we have a hard time switching out of that dialect unless we learn it both ways. When you're acting and you're learning script, you should try to break up the way you learn it. Memorize it in lots of different ways. That way you won't get stuck in one neural pathway memory. Three main types of memories: sensory, short-term, and long-term. But wait, there's more! Long-term memory can be broken down into two distinct types of memory. There's explicit and there's implicit. Okay, so explicit memories, also called declarative memories, are any kind of fact that you can declare. Anything that you can spit back, information, dates, names, colors, all that kind of stuff are explicit memories. Implicit or procedural memories are procedures that your body learns and you don't really have any conscious awareness of the processes and the steps and how you learned that. It's not something that you can recall and speak to. It's a procedural thing, like riding a bike or doing the dishes or tying a shoe. Implicit or procedural memories are learned by practice and repetition, and they become a subroutine or an algorithm that your body uses over and over and over again. If you think of your brain like a computer, the hippocampus is like your CPU, and your procedural memories are kind of stored in your operating system. Anytime you learn a new skill or procedure that can be repeated without having to think about it, that gets stored into your operating system as an implicit memory. And then anything that is explicit, anything that you create that is data related, is stored on your hard drive in various folders. Explicit memories, facts and information, all go through the hippocampus, and most of that information is stored in your temporal cortex. Procedural memories don't necessarily go through the hippocampus, but they are stored in different areas. So skills that you learn, like riding a bike or hammering a nail or tying your shoe, those are all stored in the putamen. Instincts like grooming, eating, digesting, those are all stored in the caudate nucleus. And things like timing and body coordination, hand-eye coordination, those are all stored in the cerebellum. You might not really care where things are stored in the brain because, you know, you might have a desktop that looks like this. But kind of knowing that these different kinds of memories are stored in different areas of your brain might help you access them a little bit better. Now hold on, there's still more. So within your explicit or declarative memories, there are two main categories. There are episodic memories and there are semantic memories. Episodic memories are sequences of events in our past. They are episodes from our life, and they are drawn from a combination of different stored elements: visuals, audio, smells, sights, sounds. They're very autobiographical in nature. We always put ourselves in the middle of that story, and we remember it from our perspective. These memories are usually associated with specific emotions, time periods, places, and events that happen in our lives. We see ourselves as actors in these events, much like being on stage. And there is usually a context surrounding these events and some emotional charge involved. And now, semantic memories are any kind of facts that are not associated with us. So names of places, the functions of objects, mathematics, symbols, anything that's a fact or a representation, something that's associated with verbal cues, is a semantic memory. And these are independent of personal experience. Just the facts, ma'am. So there's an interesting book I read called Sleepover. It's a novel. I put a link down below. And in it, there is a chapter that is written from the perspective of a gamer. And this gamer character makes an interesting observation. When we consume different kinds of media, like books and movies, we look at those characters from a third-person perspective. So when you're telling somebody about a book, you say, Mary did this, and then she had a child, and then she divorced her husband. Whereas if you're a gamer and you play games, you think of yourself in the first person. It's autobiographical in nature. You think, I killed the boss monster, I saved the princess. Even if you're playing a recognizable character like Mario, you don't say Mario did this and Mario did that. You say, I jumped over the wall, I hit the brick. Same thing can be said of virtual reality experiences as opposed to movies and film. When you recall a film, you say, and Margaret did a dance with Elvis and they fell in love. If you know what movie I'm talking about, tell me in the comments below. Now in VR, you experience the world around you as if you are the main character. So it's very episodic and it implants in your brain the memories of VR implant in your brain just like the memories of a dream or memories of an experience. Whereas when you watch a movie, it's very semantic in nature, it's very fact-based. Interestingly enough, episodic memories will eventually transition into semantic memories over time as the brain sort of compartmentalizes that episode into a fact. For instance, if you just came off of a show, you might remember the experience very vividly. And it's autobiographical in nature, you are the actor in it, and you remember the sights, the sounds, the smells, the struggles, the details, and any little bit of that can recall that episode. 10 years from now, you might recall that as a semantic fact. Oh yeah, that show, I did that show. It's a fact and it doesn't recall a full-on episode. Now if you dig down, you'll still discover that those neural pathways are there as you recall the things from the show. The different aspects of an episode are stored in different areas of the brain. The music that you heard is stored in an area of the brain. The taste of the wine is stored in an area. The conversations you had are stored in another area. And there's neural pathways associating all those memories into one episode. And any one of those pieces of information can later drum up this episode. Ever hear a piece of music and it brought back memories of an old relationship or maybe you tasted something and you associated it with your childhood? Those kind of things are bringing back episodic memories. All this for 1995, but wait, there's more. You also get these kind of memories. Spatial memory, which allows you to recreate mental maps of your space and how big it is and how small it is and what the relationship between north and south and all that stuff is. Autobiographical memory, which is sort of like episodic memory, but it basically allows you to remember whether you were a part of something or you're separate from it. Flashbulb memories. These are usually associated with a very emotional time in your life, like an assassination attempt or 9/11 or something like that. We all remember what we were doing at that moment. The thing about the flashbulb memories is that they're often very inconsistent because we've replayed them over in our head over and over and over again. We introduce little changes and little minor flaws in how we remember it. But it's usually thought of as something that you will never forget. You will never forget the Alamo, right? And then there's retrospective memory versus prospective memory. Retrospective memory is anything we remember from our past. So remember at the beginning of this video, I told you to remember to subscribe. And so prospective memory is anything in the future. And we usually set triggers and reminders and alarms for ourselves. It's all done on your phone nowadays. But an example might be, when you get to the end of the video, you will remember to subscribe. Prospective memory is a way of triggering your idea. So when you're learning a monologue, you can set little triggers. When you get to this word, when you hear this sound, you will remember this. And so you're associating a trigger with a prospective memory, something you're gonna reach in the future. This is a lot to digest. I hope some of it sunk into different areas of your cerebellum and putamen and hippocampus and all that stuff. And as always, please remember to what? Subscribe, yes. And like this video, share this video if you found it useful, and watch some of the other videos that may or may not be on your screen right now. Hope to see you next time. Bye.